everyone. Welcome to Sunday Assembly. If you guys can make your way to the chairs in here, this is our 53rd Sunday Assembly. And to celebrate, I'm going to be playing this fancy xylophone. Or not. We have a media-free section over on this side of the room. We have a recorded section. Well, we'll get the back of your heads on this side of the room. We have coffee and tea.
Just back up. Just use the arrow keys on the keyboard.
We have technical difficulties.
Or that.
Our recurring guest. And we have childcare over there. So drop off mostly my kids and and then don't think about them again for an hour until they make faces through the class.
What she said. Hey, it's a good crowd today. Nice to see everybody. So we're going to sing a song. Stephen, when he sometimes says, well, we're Sunday Assembly and we like to get together and sing silly songs. But we never sing silly songs. But we're going to today. Now, just looking at the title, does anybody in the room know this song? One, two, people went to camp. Okay. Child development person. Okay, so two people know it. This was a takeoff from some Dr. Seuss silliness. Got turned into a song. You know what? Looks like we need some more chairs. Chairs. Oh, Dan. Great. So, hit it. Our Uncle Walter's quite different, you know. He's been that way all of his life. Mom said so. It's not that he's violent or falls down the stairs. Just he goes waltzing, waltzing with bears. Here's the chorus. Wah, 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 wah. He goes, wah, 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 waltzing with bears. I always get this next line wrong. You do it right. It doesn't matter what I do. Raggy bears, shaggy bears, baggy bears too. And there's nothing on earth Uncle Walter won't do. So he can go waltzing, wah, 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 waltzing. So he can go waltzing with. Now, this song is in 3/4 time, which means you cannot sit still, and I'd prefer that you stand. So please do if you want. If you don't want, you don't have to. But see, we can do a little dancing here if we get up. He goes wah 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 waltzing with bears. Raggy bear, shaggy bear, baggy bears. And there's nothing on earth Uncle Walter won't do. If he can go waltzing, wah wah waltzing. So he can go waltzing, waltzing. You guys sound good. That's fun. Oh, I went to his room in the middle of the night, tiptoed inside, and I turned off the light. But to my surprise, he was nowhere in sight. Because my Uncle Walter was waltzing at night. He goes wah 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 waltzing with bears, raggy bears, shaggy bears, baggy bears. And there's nothing on earth Uncle Walter won't do. I bought Uncle Walter a new coat to wear. When he came home, it was covered with hair. And lately, I noticed several new tears. I'm afraid Uncle Walter's been waltzing with bears. He goes wah 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 waltzing with bears. Raggy bears, shaggy bears, baggy bears. And there's nothing on earth Uncle Walter won't do. If he so he can go waltzing, waltzing with goes wild. He goes wah 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 wah. You may sit.
I like the animal theme. So here, who here is here just because they love lemurs? Yes! And who here, it's their very first Sunday assembly they've ever been to? All right! Wow. That's awesome. And do we have anyone here from the SMART program? A few, yeah, a whole row. That's awesome. So we're Sunday Assembly. We're a secular, non-religious congregation that meets just to celebrate life. Our motto is to live, I always mix this up, help often, live better, and wonder more. It's not wonder often and help.
Help better.
Better.
And yeah.
Help better.
And people. Waltz with bears.
And waltz with bears. And lemurs are not bears. I learned that from a Google search. Then I lost a bet with my daughter about what a primatologist was, so. So you get the cream of the crop today. Another segment we do is Life Happens, and this is how we get to know each other. We have a booth up front, and you can put your life events. They can be sad or happy or just important to you in some way. So the first one, and sorry if I'm bad at reading these. Our grandma, this is C's mom, her name Cecilia, is here visiting from Nebraska. It's her first ever Sunday Assembly from the Polino family. I passed the very challenging Board of Psychology, Law, and Ethics exam, and I'm now waiting for my California Clinical Psychology License number from Lynn. Al Cox is back after about a year's absence, having survived both cancer and chemotherapy. He's been cancer-free for 7 months now. And Jen is in here today, who usually helps out with our children's program, because she's taking her very last baby to college this weekend. Her youngest son, freshman year, San Francisco. Next stop, empty nest syndrome, it says at the bottom. Julie quit her job of 12 years and got a new job in the cancer field. Wow. Oh, career field, sorry. Everyone, be sure to congratulate Julie for cancer, the cancer field, and remember that from forever on. Okay, in her career field, that is hard to do. I have a degree in psychology and biblical studies, so stay-at-home mom, here I come. And then is Lewis here? No, we're gonna skip life, or help happens. Although some of us went last night and fed the homeless, we had a crowd of about, I want to say, 20 people, and half of them assemblers, and we just made sandwiches and packed water bottles, and we had string cheese, we had everything we need to just feed people, and people were asking for wet wipes, for hand sanitizer, and for new socks. So if that is something that you're interested in providing, you can always give it to me. You can stop by my house and give it to me. You can bring it to assembly. It's items we always need. Another item was men's jackets with hoods. That's gonna come up when the weather gets better. And by better, I mean colder, right? All right, our reading today is done by Amber.
Humans are adorable, by the writer known as T-Bot on the blog It's the Red Kryptonite Robin. Supporting evidence. One, humans say ow, even if they haven't actually been hurt. It's just a thing they say when they think they might have been hurt but aren't sure yet. Two, humans collect shiny things and decorate their bodies and nests with them. The shinier the better, although each individual has a unique taste for style and coloring. Three, humans are not an aquatic or even amphibious species, but they flock to bodies of water simply to play in it. They can't even hold their breath all that long. They just love to splash. Four, when night falls and the sky goes dark, humans become drowsy and begin to cocoon themselves in soft, fluffy bedding. Five, some humans spend time in each other's nests. Just for fun, it's not their nest. They are just visiting each other. Six, some humans use pigments and dyes to make their bodies flashy and colorful. They even attach shiny dangly bits to their cartilaginous membranes. Seven, humans are very clever and sometimes adopt creatures from other species into their family units. They don't seem to notice the obvious differences and often raise them alongside their own young. Eight, if a human sees another creature in distress, they can commonly be observed trying to help, even at their own risk. Most humans are very deeply compassionate creatures. I like to think so. Nine, if a human hears a particularly catchy sound or tune, it will often mimic it, even to the point of annoying themselves. 10, sneezes are entirely involuntary and completely adorable, especially when the human in question becomes so frustrated. 11, humans love treats, some more than others. Many humans will save these treats specifically for a later date when they are in need of comfort or reassurance, such as pickles, Pop-Tarts, ice cream, popsicles. 12, they're learning to travel in space. They can't get very far, but they are trying. So far, they've made it to the end of their yard and they have found rocks.
That's amazing. I feel like a cat wrote this. So today's speaker is Marni LaFleur, and she is a professor of anthropology at the UCSD. She's a primatologist, and she's allowing me to call her a lemurtologist. And she's a cat enthusiast. Lemurologist. Welcome, Marni.
Okay, hi everybody. Thank you for coming. It's nice to see such a happy big crowd, so welcome. Okay, so here's what I'm going to talk about. I'm just going to tell you a little bit more about myself really briefly. And then I'm going to, on the DL, convince you that you also love lemurs. Although I saw that there are some people here who already do, so I'm sorry, I didn't mean to marginalize you. And so how I'm going to do this, I'm going to tell you about some particularly interesting species and some facts and about those species. So in particular, the Indri, the fat-tailed dwarf lemur. Don't you just want to know more about that already? Mouse lemurs, and my favorite animal on this planet, the eye-eye, even though that's not what I study. I'll then tell you about my second favorite animal, which is the ring-tailed lemur. And then I'll get a little bit more professorial and talk to you a bit about mammalian energetics, which has been sort of the basis of my research, and the evolution of female dominance in lemurs, which I think is particularly interesting for a whole bunch of reasons. And unfortunately, there's some trouble in lemur paradise, so I've got a couple of slides about what you can do to help these great animals. Okay, and this is Pipsqueak. He was a baby of the group that I study this year. He's the only surviving baby of 3 years in this forest, so it was a pleasure to visit with Pipsqueak. Okay, so briefly about me, I am a lifelong animal lover. So there's a picture of me from about 35 years ago with a puppy. I have a background in both biology and anthropology, so those are sort of my interests. I spend about 2 months a year in Madagascar, sometimes longer. I try to keep it to 2 months because that allows me to continue having a husband who welcomes me home. I'm a cat enthusiast, so if you've never been, what a lovely crowd, if you've never been to the Delmore Cat Show, which happens every year in January, it's fabulous. You should go to that. So that's my cat in the middle there, that's Stinker Bell. She's a pleasure and a devil. I'm a taco enthusiast as well. So right now, my favorite fish taco is, if you eat fish tacos, is at Don Bravo, which is in Bird Rock. So I recommend you go down to Don Bravo, get yourself a regular size fish street taco. Okay, and I brought a friend today, so my friend Lauren is here. You can say hi to Lauren. This photo, there's a photo of Lauren there looking really weird. We were in Madagascar waiting for a ferry, and we didn't know if it was going to come, and we packed ourselves a block of cheese, but then all we had was a fork. So we were sharing a block of cheese with a fork. Okay, so on to lemurs, convincing you that you love lemurs. So if you, just in case you don't know, lemurs are primates. So we're talking about primates today, and all primates are, of course, mammals. So within mammals, we're talking about primates, and then we're talking about lemurs. Lemurs are only naturally found on the island of Madagascar. So you can see them in some zoos, but all of those animals were originally taken from Madagascar and then bred in zoos. You can't find them naturally outside of Madagascar. Madagascar is a large island off of the east coast of Africa. Not all species of lemur can survive in captivity. So you can see some species in zoos, but not all of those species you can see. So anyone know who these two are? First of all, who's this guy? Somebody know? Yeah? Zubumafu, absolutely. So this was a Kratz Brothers show that was popular in the 2000s, I believe. So it was the wrong time for me. I didn't actually watch it, but my students know about Zubumafu. And this guy, anybody know what this guy? King, what's his name? Yeah, King Julian. So today we're going to be talking about lemur females and mammalian energetics, and I'll get you to tell me at the end what's wrong with having King Julian. Okay, so just a little bit about lemur diversity. There are 113 recognized species. They are incredibly diverse, so they come in a whole bunch of different shapes and forms. And there's also been a recent extinction of 17 species, and these were the giant lemurs. So as little as 500 years ago, there were lemurs the size of gorillas. Okay, so now I'm going to tell you about those few species. The first is the Indri. So this is the largest extant or living lemur. They weigh about 20 pounds. And they look like large, strange teddy bears. These guys are pair bonded, so they choose a mate and they stick with them for life unless they don't reproduce, and then sometimes they can have divorces and find other mates. They are the second loudest primate. Does anybody know who the loudest primate is?
Primates?
No. Howler monkeys are the loudest primates. So they're almost as loud as howler monkeys. You feel like you're next to an ambulance if you hear them call. And these guys duet. So because they have that special pair bond, they duet every morning, which serves to allow the animals to bond to one another, but also to tell other pairs that this is their territory. Indri cannot survive in captivity, so if you want to see an Indri, you have to go to Madagascar. And now, I've got a little video clip here, if you wouldn't mind just hitting play on that one. This one? You bet, yep. So this is last year in Madagascar.
How's it going, Lauren?
This is Lauren.
What's happening?
So many things.
That's the Indri. We can't see them, we can just hear them.
Okay, so the Indri are really special to hear and to see, and Lauren is really great to travel with because she cries at everything, and it makes everything feel like extra special. Okay, so the fat-tailed dwarf lemur is the next one I'll tell you about. These guys are really cool. They can hibernate underground for up to 7 months of the year, and they do. So they in those 7 months, they live off the fat stores that are in their tail. So you can see, if you can see this tail here, that is a very fat tail that this animal is going to live off for quite some time. And so they can put on about 75 grams, which is a significant amount of their body weight in their tail. And they also, if you can see in this photo, they burrow. So they dig themselves a hole in the ground, they crawl into that hole, put a little brush over top of them, and they don't come out for 7 months. So it's really remarkable. It's the only primate that can do this. So you can see these guys, of course, in Madagascar, but a little closer, you can see the fat-tailed dwarf lemur at the Duke Lemur Center in North Carolina. And here is a series of camera trap photos from a researcher friend of mine looking at the burrow as this animal is emerging after 7 months. Okay, mouse lemurs are the next ones I want to talk about briefly. So mouse lemurs, as you might expect, these are small. They're the smallest primate. Madame Berthe's mouse lemur is just 30 grams, so that's like 3 to 4 paper clips or a AA battery. So these guys are just teeny tiny little things. And despite their size, they're very strong. So they can pull up to 10 times their body weight. So think about doing a pull-up. I can't even do a pull-up of my own body weight. They can do a pull-up that is 10 times their body weight. So they're super strong little guys. They also have giant testes. So during certain times of the year, when it's time for mating, the males can have testes that are 8 times that what we would predict for a same-size mammal. If this were the same in human men, it would be like having 2 very large grapefruits. Which would be tricky, right? That would be tricky. They're very long-lived, so they live about 6 times longer than a same-sized mammal, than a same-sized rodent. And you can see these guys also at the Duke Lemur Center or, of course, in Madagascar. Okay, I told you this is my favorite animal. I simply love the eye-eye. So for a long time, they were mistaken for squirrels. So scientists first thought that eye-eyes were squirrels for quite a long time. And this is for a few reasons. One is that their incisors continuously grow. So like a rodent, their teeth continuously grow. It's the only primate that has this. They have percussive foraging with an elongate middle finger. So right here, this is the hand of an eye-eye, and you can see that really long finger in the middle there. That's the one that they use to tap on trees. They listen, they use echolocation with their big ears for grubs, and then they use their continuously growing incisors to dig into the tree. They have a preference for alcohol. So a recent study showed that they would always choose alcohol in liquid over not having alcohol in liquid, and they would always choose the strongest that they were provided over not having, over a weak drink. They always want a stiffer drink. And you can see these wonderful creatures here at the San Diego Zoo. And now is a really good time to see them because the zoo is open at night and eye-eyes are nocturnal. So what you need to do if you want to see these guys is to go around dusk and wait outside their enclosure and then wait for them to wake up and come out of their sleeping boxes. Okay, so could you click on the archive? I just want to show you these guys, their percussive foraging because it's so neat. That's their finger. They're just really remarkable little animals. Okay, and last but not least, of course, is the ring-tailed lemur. So these guys are interesting. They have an activity pattern called cathemeral, which means they can be active at any time in the day or night. These guys live in large social groups of up to 30 animals. They're really robust. They've been said to be tough as old boots because they can just get through sort of the worst of times. They are strictly female dominant. So lemurs have this trait of female dominance, and ring-tailed lemurs are like the most extreme case of this. Females are always dominant over males. And of course, you can also see these guys at the San Diego Zoo. Okay, so just in case you don't love them yet, a couple of more factoids. This is a little bamboo lemur. Bamboo lemurs can eat enough cyanide in a day to kill 6 adult humans. Here is a dancing, called a dancing lemur, or a Verus shifaka, so they're really amazing when they locomote on the ground. And here is a baby blue-eyed black lemur. This is the only non-human primate to have blue eyes. So lots of reasons to love lemurs. Okay, so now I'm going to talk more about mammalian energetics, which is a little bit more theoretical. Okay, starting with basic animal ecology. So why do animals live in groups? What's the reason that an animal would choose to live in a group? You tell me. Safety, yes, absolutely. So, yes, absolutely, and also to have mates. So one of the reasons to live in a group is that your group members can see predators, will see predators more often because there's more eyes around. And then also, if a predator is going to take somebody, if you're one of 20, your chances of being taken are much better than if you're one of one, right? But there are costs. So what's the cost to living in a group? Many mouths and resources, exactly. So more mouths to feed, and so you have to spend a lot more time trying to find food if you have to share it among 20 individuals. So many animals do choose to live in groups because those benefits outweigh the costs. And now talking about mating conflicts. So from an evolutionary perspective, on the most basic level in mammals, and please don't apply this to humans or to animals that have rich culture, because these rules just fall apart as soon as we get there. But just talking about mammals without very rich culture, females compete over food, and this is because reproduction in females is quite costly, and this is what limits them. So the amount that they can reproduce is tied to the amount of food that they can get, and so this is what they compete over. And for males, males compete over females, and that's because the amount that a male can reproduce is tied to the number of females he can access. So for males, although it's not always, reproduction is comparably cheap when compared to a female. And so females are what limit the fitness of males. So this really basic imbalance leads to female choice of mates and male competition for females. So almost always, females choose their mate. Coercion is found. Coercion is the word that we use for rape in non-human animals. And the reason we don't say rape is because we don't have any evidence to suggest that the emotional or cultural implications tied to rape in humans are also found in other animals. So we call it coercion. But this is really quite rare. Generally speaking, females have the choice of who they mate with. Okay. So there is selection pressure then for increased body size, weaponry, showy traits, and generally being impressive in male mammals. And as a byproduct of this, males are almost always socially dominant. So they're bigger, they tend to be more aggressive, not always, but they tend to be, they have big teeth, they have all of these traits to be really showy and to show the females that they're very impressive. And so they tend to be dominant. So I told you about one case where this happens, where female dominance occurs in mammals, and that is in all of the lemurs. And there's only 2 other cases of this in mammals. Does anybody know what those are? Anybody want to take a guess? No, not elephants. Elephants are matriarchal, but the females aren't dominant. Yeah. So I've defined this as individual dominance. In bonobos, the females band together to dominate, but they don't do it on their own. So lemur females are individually dominant. Yeah. Yes, naked mole rats is one of them. So two mammal species in one mammal family, so naked mole rats is one. And in naked mole rats, the male or non-queen female are quite small, 30 to 35 grams, and the queen is large, so more than twice the size of the others. So she dominates the rest of the group with her size, also with pheromones, but mostly with her size. And the next one is the spotted hyena. Has anybody ever heard of these animals before? They're just so remarkable. You need to Google these animals if you don't know about them, because they're really cool. So in these animals, again, the male is quite a bit smaller than the female, so she can dominate in some way with her size. They also have these really unusual masculinized traits. So this is a drawing of a female, and you can see she's got what looks like a big penis. It's actually called a pseudopenis, and that morphology is her clitoris has been elongate. And so she only has one external opening for her urethra and vagina. So she urinates through there, copulates through there, and gives birth through there. So it's this tiny little, it's very tricky. So you should really, you want to find something to read about on Google, you should read about this because it's interesting. My students always love hearing about these guys. I do too. Okay, so this begs the question as to why this whole group of animals, all of the lemurs, the males and the females are the same size, why do they have this unusual dominance system, and how are they able to maintain their dominance socially? So this question has driven much of my research. I'll just explain Madagascar and lemurs a little bit more. So the landmass of Madagascar was separate from both India and Africa about 88 million years ago, and the ancestral primate that eventually became lemurs rafted, or we think they rafted, probably on a floating mass of vegetation. Has anybody seen the movie The Life of Pi? Yes. Okay, so you know the meerkats that live on this floating vegetation island? That's kind of the idea that we think of, a little less so that they actually had rowboats. So something more like floating landmass. And then the lemurs evolved for really long periods of time without the suite of animals that we see on most landmasses. So few competitors and few predators. And also the environment of Madagascar is strange, and we think that it has been quite strange in the past, in that it's hyper-variable, which means that within the year and between years, rain is quite unpredictable. So it's difficult to know when it's going to be a good time of year or a good season. So in addition to that, the lemurs have other traits that are unusual. They have female dominance. They also have low basal metabolic rates. They have very strict seasonal breeding, which is not necessarily unusual for animals, but unusual for tropical animals. Weaning synchrony, cathemerality, as I've told you, and torpor or hibernation in some. And so trying to understand this, there's a hypothesis proposed by Patricia Wright, where you may have heard of if you've seen the Island of Madagascar movie. And this suggests that lemur female dominance results from an adaptation that gives them feeding priority, which is necessary in their unusual environment. So that the stochasticity or the unpredictable nature within and between years means that food is particularly limited, and this helps them in their fitness. And so this is one of the things that I've looked at extensively, and I've tested this through looking at feeding behavior and nutrition. And so what I do is I go out and I follow individual lemurs and I watch every single little bite that they take, record that, collect samples that are similar to that, weigh every single little sample. Then I don't do it myself, but have a lab do the nutritional analysis on these and compose an estimate for the amount of calories that they take in a day. And then compare all females to all males to see if there's a difference there. And it does seem like this gives them a caloric advantage. So simply because they are socially dominant, they get a different diet, and it seems like that diet is better for them. So yes, my data does suggest this, but there's a fair amount of error in this, and I'm not quite completely satisfied yet. I don't think any scientist ever really is. But if you think about every single little bite that an animal takes, And the amount of error that you have to build in there, thinking about when you don't get it quite right, and then comparing between animals, is your error greater than the difference between or not? So this is the problem that I'm having. But there's another way to do this now since I originally started this research, and that's looking at C-peptide. And C-peptide is a correlate of insulin. So every time you eat, you have increased levels of insulin or C-peptide, and you can measure this through urine. And so I've been collecting male and female lemur urine for about 6 years. Woo! And what people always want to know when I say that is, how the heck do you do that? And if you can see right here, it's a little disposable pipette, plastic pipette. So you look for a lemur doing a little squat pee pose, and then I am on that. And you just gotta suck it up and then put it in a little tube and label it and everything, and that's it. It's not that tricky. And it's really rewarding. When you get a good pee sample, oh my God. Okay, but as I said, there's some trouble in lemur paradise. So lemurs are the most threatened group of mammals on Earth. And you may have seen this in the news recently. So I just pulled these off of my news feed yesterday. And the threats to lemurs include habitat destruction, the bushmeat trade, live capture for the pet trade, and also the impacts of climate change. So what can you do? You can dedicate your lives to studying and understanding these amazing animals. Okay, so maybe you can't do that. But you can always learn more, and you can spread the word. You can volunteer, as many of you already do, and you can donate to causes that are looking out for these guys. Also, think about traveling responsibly. So maybe you may not be going to Madagascar, but many people do go to Madagascar, and they may engage in activities that accidentally, that they don't realize, fuel the illegal capture of wild lemurs. So please, when you're traveling, don't ever pay to interact with wildlife. Madagascar or not Madagascar, don't ever pay to interact directly with wild animals. And you can minimize your carbon footprint, because one of the things that's threatening these guys is climate change. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you.
That was amazing. I have so many questions about which drunken scientist first was like, I see an eye, I have a bottle of liquor. And you know what I love to sing when I'm liquored up and feeling particularly primate dominance? That's your segue, Paul.
That's my segue. So when we were talking a month ago about female dominance, we decided that this would be a cool song to sing. First of all, because it's a cool song, and second of all, because it sort of was thematic. And then, you know, Aretha had the wherewithal to pass away this week, so then this becomes much more important, I think. So, you know, let's all sing it a little bit. I'll see if I can play it. Looking out on the morning rain, I used to feel so uninspired. And when I knew I had to face another day, oh, it made me feel so tired. Before the day I met you, life was so unkind, but you're the key to my peace of mind. 'Cause you make me feel, come on now, you make me feel, you make me feel like a natural. And when my soul was in the lost and found, you came along to claim it. I didn't know just what was wrong with me till your kiss helped me name it. Now I'm longer doubtful of what I'm living for, and if I make you happy, I don't need to do more. 'Cause you make me feel, you make me feel. what you've done to me. You make me feel so good inside. And I just wanna be close to you. You make me feel so alive. You make me feel like a natural. One more.
Personal moment, which is a lot of people's favorite time. It can be any one of you talking about anything personal to you. We have had deep stuff, domestic violence, battles with cancer, battles with mental illness. We have had light stuff, stealing a donut from your parents. Video games was one. So anything you want to talk about, you can, and we love it. And if you don't feel like I can't stand up in front of people and talk, we have readers, if you want to write it out, that will read it for you. We can turn off the camera. We can make it happen because we want to get to know each other, and it's one of the best ways to do that. Today, our personal moment is by John.
Hi, I'm John Siegel, and I think that I was paired up with Marni to keep the animal theme. So a little bit about who I am. I'm a San Diego native, and my mother was an exotic bird breeder. She owned and operated Sunshine Bird Farm for 25 plus years, and so from the time that I was about 11 or 12 years old, I started handling birds. And so I would go and groom parrots with her. For many, many years, I would help her and hold the bird while she would give it a bath and blow dry it. And that led to a career in the pet trade. So I managed a lot of small pet stores and eventually ended up at Petco and was a regional manager for Petco for many years. And I love animals more than anything. I've always had pets and I'm just an animal person. And so that's a little bit of history. And I currently am a volunteer at the zoo, and the lemurs are my favorite animal. I was telling Marni before the assembly that I sit and eat my lunch in the lemur area and just watch them. So I love animals. So this is my story. I live on Mission Bay, and so I was driving along the road. This is probably about 9 months ago. I was driving along the road that goes along Mission Bay, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw this bird. So the bird that I'm going to tell you the story about is called a blue heron. And if you don't know what a blue heron looks like, it stands about 3 to 4 feet tall and has a wingspan of 5 to 6 feet. It's a huge bird. And out of the corner of my eye, I see this bird standing there on the grass at Mission Bay, which is unusual. And there's people kind of milling around this bird. So I pull my car over and I see this bird and I get out of my car and these people are like, look at this bird. This bird's just standing there. It's so unusual. And I kind of start moving towards this bird and I've never experienced anything like this. This is why I'm here telling this story. This bird literally looked into my eyes and approached me. Was probably about 10 feet away from me, and this bird walked up to me and brought its head close enough for me to actually touch this bird. All these people are like, oh my God, it wants something from you, it wants something from you, and I'm like, I don't know what it wants. So I actually kind of take a step towards my car, it's parked over to the left, and this bird is almost attached to my hip. It's literally up against me. And I'm like, and so I start talking to it, are you okay? And I notice that its wing is broken. So its wing is kind of slumped down. And I swear to you, this bird was looking me in the eye, and I was like, oh man. And the people around start saying, you need to help it. It's obviously coming to you for help. Okay, so even if I don't want to at this point, I'm feeling pretty obligated because there's about 15, 20 people standing around watching this bird bond to me. So I'm thinking to myself, how can I do this? How can I help this bird? Like I said, this is a huge bird, and so people start persuading me to take it with you and get it into the car. And I drive a Honda Accord. Fortunately, it's a four-door, so I have a back seat. So I'm looking at this bird. This bird is literally just, you know, pleading with me through its eyes to take it. And fortunately, like I mentioned, I have history handling birds. So I go and I take this bird. And this isn't, you know, like grabbing a pigeon. This is a big bird. When I put my arms around this bird, it melted into me. This bird did not resist. This bird knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that I was going to help it. And I put the bird into the back seat of my Honda Accord, and the bird folded its legs down and sat down on the back seat and cocked its head and looked at me and was like, I'm ready to go. I don't know if there are pictures, but I have pictures of the bird in the back seat. Perfect. So the bird's in the back seat of my car. It's after hours, it's after business hours, it's kind of starting to get dark, so probably like 6-7 o'clock in the evening. And the bird's in the back seat of my car. I'm Googling Project Wildlife, bird rescue, what do I do with this bird? How do I help this bird? No place is open. People are saying, oh yeah, I don't know if it was a Saturday, and people are like, yeah, bring it over on Monday. I have two cats at home. The bird was not coming home with me. So I spent hours. I probably had this bird in the back seat of my car for 2 to 3 hours, pulling over, talking to it, telling him he only pooped twice. And both times, it was totally contained on the back seat, so that was a good thing. The bird was so well-behaved. And I was Googling places and calling places, and it started getting late at night. And I think that it was probably around 11 o'clock when, in my mind, I remembered that there's a humane society down off Marina Boulevard that used to be open to the public, but no longer is. And I happen to know that it's there because it's close to my house. And so I thought, you know, this is the only chance that I have. So I pull up, and there's like one car there. And I'm thinking, okay, there's got to be someone here. So the bird patiently was waiting in the car. And I started going around this building and literally knocking on all the doors, all the windows. There's no one to be found. I finally kind of go heading back to the car, and out comes this young woman who was volunteering there and spending her time cleaning stuff up. And so she was there at like 11:30 at night, and she comes out. Were you knocking? And I said, yeah, you gotta help me, please. So I bring her out to the car, and I say, I have this bird, can you please help me? And she says, I don't know, let me get on the phone and see what I can do. So she gets on the phone, and about 10 minutes later, she comes out and she says, okay, I'll take it. We'll take it and we will you know, do something to help the bird. We'll find it a place probably in the morning. And so she took this bird from me, put it into a huge dog kennel. And at that point, I was like, I'm done. I'm not doing anything else. The bird was safe. And in the morning, I called that facility and I said, hey, I brought this bird to you last night. I want to kind of follow up and find out what happened. And they said, oh, it just left. SeaWorld came and picked it up. And if you don't know, SeaWorld has one of the biggest bird rehabilitation facilities in the county. So that was the end of my relationship with the heron, and I know that it was well cared for, and they asked me exactly where I found it so that after it was fixed up, they could bring it back exactly to the spot that I grabbed it from. So that is my story.
I kept waiting for the end where the bird grants him three wishes. And we have our youth group now for kids around 12 and up who want to discuss lemurs, discuss what we already went over, or just to hang out. Sometimes they fly them with chocolate. And they are meeting right in the back next to our representative teens and preteens there. Now it's my turn. I want a chair. Because I like when no one can see me in the back row. Or I'll sit in the chair like I do. It makes everyone nervous. No California earthquakes today. Oh, so far. I grabbed the wrong papers. Now I get to do it again. What? Steven does magic tricks. This is my only trick. So when I found out I would be emceeing today, and I asked for the theme and was told lemurs, I went home to my MC addresses in the big filing cabinet, went to L, pulled out lemurs, and no, I Googled, what is a lemur? And then my Wild Kratts fan at home went, oh, it's a primate, Mom. So now I know. But it was when I first heard I was gonna be emceeing that Lynn leaned over and went, oh, they have strong matriarchs. Like, they're a female-run society. And I'm like, that I know about. That I can talk about. Because I grew up, and I, first slide. I grew up with this woman, but she never looked like that. This was my matriarch, the matriarch of our family and extended family. Her name was Gladys Lucille Record. She hated the name Gladys, so she went by Grandma Lucy. Gladys the cow was also popular in Sesame Street when I think my mom was little, and so Gladys went out the door. I didn't know her real name till I got her mail one day. But she ran our family, and we grew up in a religious community that no one religious here would recognize as good. It was very strict. And even though our red-faced preacher would rail against women in authority, somehow, like a female Illuminati, all the women ran this community, and they got it done. Now, as matriarch implies, there's a system of motherhood. We were really encouraged to get married really young and have kids really young. My mom, her next slide. That's my mom with my grandma. This was a few years before my mom's wedding. She was, I think, 15 when she got engaged. That's about the average. My grandma got married very young as well, both grandmas. And I met my husband when I was 16. So there's a big push to have children and then shape those children. And that is how our kind of society was run, our super primate society. Next slide. This is how I knew her. By the time I came around, this is what she looked like. She wasn't the first or second pictures to me. She was always this, larger than life, very much a woman who emotionally took up space in a room and took up the causes of those around her. She took people to chemo. She bussed children with special needs. She volunteered everywhere. She also was my mother's co-parent and helped raise me. So every morning, she would come to my house, she lived 3 minutes down the road, and she would bring day-old donuts and expired sourdough bread. And that was our breakfast and lunch, and ramen was our dinner. And she would clean up. She was such a spotless person that growing up, my Aunt Linda says, it was like magic. She took off a dirty article of clothing, left it anywhere, and it would magically appear, folded in her drawer, and all clean the next day. And there's a great story where my mom moved out to her first apartment with her new husband, called Grandma crying, "Something's wrong with my apartment." Like all the time, no matter the surface, there's this weird film of something like dirt, but it's everywhere. She didn't know what dusting was or what dust was. So just because my grandma liked to take care of people, she also provided for us financially. She worked at the thrift store, and when she was on duty, somehow all the clothes in our size became marked down to 10 cents. I might have sold my swing set in order to afford my season of softball, but she was the one that bought me the mitt, the bobby socks, the batting gloves, and the special ordered helmet for my peanut head that was even smaller than all the other kids, and still is smaller than my own children. There was one time I played softball for 10 years, and she never missed a single game in 10 years. She came all the time, and she liked to yell at the umpires. So one time I got called out, and it was a bad call. I remember it. I slid into home, the catcher dropped the ball. I was still called out, and I handled it with great maturity because I wasn't the one that was going to get reamed in a few minutes. I just kind of made eye contact like, "You're brave, guy." Walked back to the bench. Now, my grandmother, I have to set the scene up better. Imagine a kid's softball game with the bleachers kind of out so the parents aren't writing your business. My grandmother remedied this by bringing her own lawn chair and setting it right up on the third baseline and scowling at the umpires. So when this call was made, that woman, lawn chair folded up under one arm, giant purse in the other, storms the field. And to this day, we always make this joke at home because the umpire said, "Lady, I would kick you out of this game if you didn't remind me so much of my granny." So that was my grandmother. She could be a hard woman. She called people dummies if they were dummies. And I was driving home from IHOP the other day, and a car cut me off on Balboa Avenue, and I was like, "Dummy." And then I caught myself like, I have a pocket full of sweeteners I stole from the table, and I'm calling people dummy. I'm one "it's just a cat" away from being Grandma Lucy. And we all know it's not just a cat. There are precious little babies, right? Actually, I think the next slide, that's my baby. This is my first foster failure, which means you don't give them back. And we adopted her this week, and I'm in love with her. And she's so cute. I almost brought her. Her name's Millie Moo Moo. And it turns into Millie Moo Moo. What else would you like to know? Okay. My grandma carried a purse the size of a small steamship, and inside could be found a million tissues crumpled up individually. Also, like a thin layer of like crushed up cough drops. So every time she unzipped it, it was like, "Whoa, menthol or mint." She also had two decks of cards in there because you can't play canasta with one deck of cards. And if you ever played canasta with her, which you could do in my family as soon as your hand was literally big enough to hold the initial 15, was she would cheat, but she would call it grandma rolls. She forgot to draw for a red 3. Didn't matter whose turn it was, as soon as she remembered, even if she was misremembering, she potted the deck. And when you caught her, she'd say, "I'm grandma, I'm old. It wouldn't be fair if you did it. You have a young brain, I have a forgetful one." She got away with this. And it actually didn't, I didn't realize at the time that she was old. She was older than everyone else's grandma. I think the next slide is her and her husband, yeah. This is my grandpa Frank. I never met him. He died when my mom was a baby. He was a miner and breathed it in until it took his heart. But she's just so spunky. She was soft and caring, hard as nails, and with this little imp personality in between. But she was born at the turn of the century. She comes from the 1800s, the pioneers. She was the first baby of the new century. She lived through the Model T car, became popular while she was alive. The flappers, suffrage, my history's terrible. The Great Depression, that's another one. Women's rights, the civil rights of Black Americans, the world wars. She had a story of having to give up her nylons for the war effort. And in exchange, she stole her husband's razor to shave her legs. She hadn't done that in a while and ruined it. And it was, woman, what'd you do to my razor? But she was like, gave up my stockings, dude. Another story was she bought pants for the very first time in her life to wear around the house. And her husband came home and ripped them off her and said, women shouldn't be in trousers. And I mentioned this story this week to my aunts and was informed that that might not be how things went down. What might have happened is the kids got home and saw a pair of pants strewn on the floor and both parents in the bedroom. And that was the story to cover up whatever activity led to the pants on the floor. So the next slide, yeah, my family, most of our pictures are black and white because my grandma was older when she had my mom. She married her husband when she was a baby and he already had two boys. She gave him three daughters, born 11 years apart each. So my Aunt Charlotte and my mom were 22-year gap. So she was an older woman when she started to parent me. These are like her parents forging through the countryside to get to California from Colorado. Next slide. Oh, it's another kitten. I just threw that in because the only reason I'm wearing this dress right now is because I wouldn't be talking about my grandmother with her permission, were she alive, if I were not wearing a dress on a Sunday morning. So if I'm invoking her memory, I have to dress up, but I have to tease her a little with the kittens, right? Right? Just a cat. All right, next slide. There she is. I remember her always in her throne, her chair. She was tough. She made it through a lot. But I saw her at her weakest moment when we were in a hospital room and she was told that her daughter had been killed. And I watched this contradiction between the strongest person I knew, the toughest person I knew, and her crumpled there, using all million of her individually crumpled Kleenexes out of that cavernous suede bag. And that's when we lost our matriarch of my nuclear family. But even though Grandma survived depression and world wars and short skirts, she wouldn't be tough enough to survive this loss. And the last big event she attended was my wedding. I married young. I've been married almost 15 years. And about a year after that, she had passed away. A year after that, I became pregnant with the most precocious Wildcats fan in the world. And I went to pick up the phone and realized the first two people I would call would not be picking up. Those well-memorized numbers would reach nowhere. And it hit me, I'm now the matriarch of my family. Oh. I had a little practice at it. After mom was killed, I took care of my dad, I parented my younger sister, but I could always escape back into being a teenager when I needed to. But this was different, this was permanent. And I realized, maybe all the matriarchs don't have it all together. Maybe they are, I think the next slide, is there a next slide? So now I'm the matriarch. It's never gonna be just a cat. I'm never gonna shave my legs. I'll never say never. I'm not the shaving legs kind of person. I'm not the kind of person that will threaten her grandchildren that they'll sneak into their beds when they're sleeping and cut off their bangs because they hate the 80s. And yeah, try it now, Grandma. But I am gonna be there because I had that example. I am gonna show up. I'm gonna love fiercely. And I'm damn well gonna scare some umpires. And now for our moment of reflection. All right, announcements. Who's making an announcement? Make your way up.
Hello, everybody. I did this last time, but we have one more assembly before this happens. We are doing our very first dinner in a drive-in movie. So we're going to eat at Denny's together, pick the movie, go next door to the drive-in movie theater, and then... Haven't you always wanted to like go and see a movie in the theater with your friends so you could talk smack during the theater and during the movie, right? In the safety of our own vehicles. So that's what we're gonna do. All right, cool.
Hi, September 1st, we're gonna go visit the Friendship Park at the, it's the most southwesterly point in the continental United States. They have a hole in the border fence, and you can cross into Mexico and the U.S. and share a garden. So that'll be September 1st, 10 o'clock.
We should probably change the slide. I don't know that it's an authentic Louisiana crawfish boil anymore. We're actually getting them from California this year because we're in a different season. But we're having a crawfish boil on the 23rd. It's going to be a hoot. Y'all come on out.
I guess we should sing the lemur sleeps tonight, but... we're not going to do that. We're going to do this. Say, om, om, om. If I can find a pick, there's one now. Om, om, om. Sing this. Hey up, boys, whim away, whim away, whim away. Try that. Hey up, boys. Hey up, boys, whim away. Come on, guys. Whim away, whim away. Women with low voices. Hey up, boys, whim away, whim away. Don't be afraid. Whim away. Everybody's going to do something. Hey up, boys, whim away, whim away. Oh, now if you've got a medium voice, now if you've got the high voices, sing this. start with the low voices, and then we'll bring in the middle voices, and we'll bring in the top voices. And then I'm going to call the recording company and have them come make a record. Here we go, low voices, hit it. Hey up, boys, whim away, whim away, whim away. Sing it again. Hey up, boys, whim away. Stand up, everybody up. Whim away. A whim away, keep it going, guys. A whim away, 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 a whim away. We're in the high part now, everybody's in. Second part. Oh, him away, oh, him away, oh, him away. Oh, the high part of my hand. Singing. You guys are awesome.
Thank you so much for coming out to our 53rd Sunday Assembly. We invite you to drink all our coffee and tea and eat all our cakes and cookies, and also remind you that we are run 100% on donations and we use volunteers. So if you would like to make a recurring monthly donation from your phone for even just $5 a month, we appreciate it a lot, and it keeps us in a Wimowetz. So
yes,
thank you.
But one more thing. People who are first-timers, raise your hand one more time, please. Okay, those of us who are regulars, go talk to those people. Okay? Cool. Thanks.
Have fun.